Hello everybody and welcome back to another video. So today we'll be taking a look at Hearthstone's more recent expansion, Rastakhan's Rumble, and what various cards ended up getting cancelled altogether before they got a chance to be released. Before we get into some of the cancelled concept and cards though, let's get some juicy backstory on the development. This is a pretty important and relevant part since a lot of these cancelled ideas or decisions weren't about misbalance or synergy, but a lot about the development and the goal that the developers had. The thing about the development process is that there were ideas and choices that had to be made if they wanted to ensure a specific style of gameplay and a certain element of fun. Rastakhan's Rumble is Hearthstone's 10th expansion. It featured 135 new collectible cards and a new alternate shaman hero, King Rastakhan. This set, as most of us know, is centered around trolls, whom of which are the most ancient races of all of Azeroth. Because of this, Blizzard wanted to really nail the theme and give the players a certain feeling when using and playing with the new set of cards. The thing is that the request for having a troll-themed set and the amount of fan arts and different concepts created long before Rastakhan's Rumble is absolutely insane. A lot of hype and a lot of pressure really surrounded this expansion, and in turn the development process and history was no short feat. The World of Warcraft expansion known as Battle of Azeroth allowed us to explore trolls in a more in-depth form, and in turn Blizzard saw this as the best opportunity to explore them more themselves by taking advantage of producing a fully troll-based theme. During development, some of the devs on the World of Warcraft side actually took tons of inspiration and various references of different Lao and troll characters and in turn used them in the Battle of Azeroth expansion. Now I'm sorry for heading a little bit off topic here, but I think the way everything ties together is definitely super interesting, but the base theme was actually discussed extensively and went over things such as Frosty Ice Troll Monastery and the search for the troll Dorabo. This, for the people who don't know, is a legendary city of gold and was just made up literally on the spot, so I guess a lot of people won't know. However, the biggest thing that they really and truly wanted to capture was the sense of diversity among the trolls and the different races and how they were scattered vastly around Azeroth and how much of a huge contrast there would be and should be between the different heritages. They simply didn't want to just tell us that they're the oldest race, but instead show us as they dig and build their history and existence deeper and deeper. Now this is something I really commend. When the team was asked about what they liked most in terms of trolls, suggestions such as Zul'jin and Hakkar, whose corrupted blood to the dinosaurs really resonated with the developers. However, nothing was more suggested and called out than Lao, the primal god and spirits worshipped by all of the trolls. He was a powerful and amazing concept to go off of, big personalities with the developers who had to handle it really right. The team concepted a lot, and this backstory actually perfectly leads us into the first cancelled card. The first thing to be worked on during the expansion development was Hakkar's Soul Flyers. However, the developers ended up deciding against placing Hakkar with a gladiator team. This is because he is mostly evil Lao, and he would more than likely end up eating all of his gladiators. So I know this is different audio with different qualities because I messed up in my commentary. I need to plug this in very quickly. So the Soul Flayer did end up being produced, as we know, the card did finish, but it went through a lot of iterations, and before it was kind of changed to this, it was Hakkar's team, and it had its own development. Development cycle. Hakkar's team was utterly scrapped. He, however, appears in the set as a neutral card. A cool fun fact was that the concept art was heavily inspired by other Lao teams in the expansion, and more particularly design elements like fans having images if Lao being printed on their chest, as well as various color schemes, weapons, and gear which are derived from the gods and their physical features. There isn't too much to say about Hakkar's team, but I definitely think that it's super cool how when they really design cards, it's heavily based around lore. If it doesn't fit their lore and doesn't fit the idea well, it's scrapped, and this is the case that happened here. We also have the Invincible Spirit cards, Ethereal Spirit cards, and large HP Spirit cards, all of which were instead of 3 HP stealth for one turn. The team designed the spirits to actually build around cards that make one's entire deck feel tailored to a specific theme. This was an extremely important part of the expansion's overarching goal, and this was to ensure that a player would actually get value out of these spirits. Developers tried various designs to make sure that they are all more resilient. A major idea that they did have was to make the spirits into invincible permanent cards, but they quickly realized that this specific idea felt really bad to play against, being pretty anti-fun. They then moved forward with another idea, being the spirits ethereal. This would be unable to be attacked by any other minions. Similarly to the idea we just mentioned, on many decks it was pretty difficult removing them, and this led to them being very anti-fun and simply an annoyance to play against. Noticing that their ideas weren't exactly hitting the mark, they decided to shoot an arrow in the opposite direction and tried to more simply give the spirits a large amount of health. Though this version of the spirits were actually good for players who were ahead on the board, it was again difficult for the opponent to rid of them. They were also not exactly effective when behind. The opponent would clear the spirits before the player even had a solid chance to make sure that their effect was even worth it. The designs then later decided to make the spirits 3 health minions with stealth for a single turn, ensuring that there was a possible solution for opponents to remove them, and the stealth also made it so that spirits were a little more likely to survive long enough for the player to actually use them in various combos. Now, if we kind of overview that design, the spirits were actually smartly designed with low mana costs on purpose. This was to ensure that the player could actually get the opportunity to use them early while their survivability was still higher. They wanted to make sure that the chances were given before the outcome of the match was already decided. The developers learned that during Kobolds and Catacombs and onwards that they enjoy their build around cards to be rare quality. This ensures more people have access to the card and don't feel locked behind the higher tier legendary rarities. The result of everything we just said was the spirit cards in Rakastan's Rumble becoming rare cards. Now, this is really cool, to be honest. I just mentioned that they really focus on lore, but there's also clearly a lot to look at game-wise, more than just synergies and if the cards work or too powerful or not powerful, more than just stats. There's just so many different variables to look at, and this is what makes me respect the developers even more. They have to make sure the card slips perfectly straight into their game and is able to be played very effectively. Next, we'll be looking at overkill. There's a couple variations here. There's the excess damage, which went to the enemy hero, splatter, which would overkill where the excess damage went to another minion, and finally overkill with an effect based on the exact damage dealt that sealed up with the damage. Now, the truth is that the design process behind overkill was actually pretty convoluted, and quite the interesting one. Kat actually mentioned himself about how it echoes the theme of crushing your opponents and dealing the excess damage. Peter followed up and pointed out that overkill as an idea and concept itself has been around for a long while, stating that it goes as far back as Black Rock Mountain times. However, back then the iteration of the excess damage went to the enemy hero, but it apparently wasn't all that interesting nor exciting. This was because it didn't change the way you played in any sort of way, which really just downplayed its desire and appeal. Then in Witchwood, overkill was actually called splatter, the same excess damage idea, but carried to another minion instead. This was actually a perfect name, but the whole theme just didn't work with the set and the random excess damage. It just wasn't very fun and simply made your opponent feel horrible. The thing is that for this expansion, we had two main versions of overkill, one of which was the amount of damage that would be inflicted mattered on a binary one, where you either triggered overkill or you simply didn't. This first version would allow you to, let's say, inflict 8 damage on a 1-to-1 minion, you then got 7 armor or drew 7 cards. The binary one ended up being a lot more interesting because it set up a more interesting moment and led to a heavier emphasis on player decision. It's funny because overkill itself is a simple concept, but it's actually super interesting to play and really pushes you to play the game in a different way than how someone may have been used to playing originally. Since instead of trying to only inflict the same exact amount of damage, you could waste damage. Mage, on the other hand, will have an easier time activating overkill, but that's besides the point of generally being all about specific cards rather than specific classes using this mechanic more than others. Tailoring it to have high synergy with another card over a specific class was an important mechanic to accomplish. It's definitely amazing how hard Blizzard works in capturing and sticking so closely to the lore, world, and overall theme they build. It's not only commendable, but admirable, as I sometimes think that it's really overlooked, and just how much work reflects in immersing the player into the game is really a lot higher than we think. Anyhow, that just about sums up the video here. What did you find the most interesting? Let us know in the comments down below, and while you're down there, let me know how I can improve the videos in the future. This is my first set of videos coming up, so there is probably a lot to improve, but I am ready to do it for you guys. Now hit that like button if you like the video, and remember to subscribe for some future content. As always, thank you for watching, and I'll catch you guys next time.